Now this is a common supercapacitor, and its main advantages are that you can charge it up super quickly and also discharge it super quickly, which sounds awesome for certain applications. Only problem is that they cannot store a lot of energy. For example, in direct comparison with such a common lithium-ion battery, it is around 90 times less. So that means they cannot be used as battery replacements. Yet, because I recently found this big boy on eBay that claims to be a graphene supercapacitor with a whopping capacity of 21,000 farads. If we do the math, and I did, then the energy density of this thing comes close to those of lithium-ion and LiPo batteries, and even surpasses that of some lithium iron phosphate batteries. It is crazy that a capacitor can do such a thing. But maybe it cannot, and I simply got scammed here, and this thing is just a relabeled big LiPo battery, since supercapacitors usually look a bit different. So in this video, in order to clear things up, we will not only do some experiments with the supercapacitor to find out what it really is, but I will also tell you why graphene could be the future for energy storage solutions. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, who can do it all. And by that I mean that you can make your schematic, design your PCB, source the components, and then let them assemble it all. This way you can save tons of time and money. And speaking of money, click the link below to get some coupons not only for their PCBA service, but also 3D printing and CNC service. So check them out today and be amazed by their quality and fast delivery time. Now first off, what is this graphene stuff? And why does every article on the internet and YouTube call it the solution for our current electrical energy storage devices? Well, graphene is kind of like graphite, that pretty much everyone is familiar with. But instead of being the crystalline form of the element carbon, that definitely comes with some interesting electrical properties on its own, graphene is just a two-dimensional single layer of carbon atoms arranged in an hexagonal structure. Needless to say, that makes manufacturing it quite difficult. But on the pro side, this material is the strongest, lightest, best heat transferring one, and also best electrically conductive one that we know of. Wow! But how exactly does it improve our supercapacitor now? I mean, if we look at other more common ones without graphene and measure their volume and weight, then we can easily figure out that the graphene increased the energy density by around 30 times, which is an incredible improvement. To find that out, let's simply open up a common supercapacitor, which was not as easy to do as I initially thought. But after 10 minutes I was in, and all we can find inside are the two terminals connected each to one long electrically conductive plate, aka electrode, that was covered in black stuff, another film for each terminal that is non-conductive, which is the separator, and some liquid stuff all around it, aka the electrolyte. If we draw that up simplified, then a supercapacitor looks something like this. And the way it stores energy is that as soon as a voltage gets applied, the negative and positive charged ions in the electrolyte gets drawn to the opposite charged electrodes, and thus an electrostatic field gets created that represents the stored energy. Now of course, the bigger the surface area of the electrodes, the more energy can get stored. But since there's obviously a physical size limit to a capacitor, they instead use this black stuff around the plates, which is actually activated carbon that is used to increase the surface area. Okay, this was the simplified way a SuperCap works, and what our graphene improvement now would do is replace the activated carbon to increase the surface area even more, besides, of course, adding some other advantages. So initially, graphene supercaps sound super, but what makes them so much better than common lithium-based batteries? Well, even though the structure of such batteries looks similar at first sight, this time you always got an electrochemical reaction going on, to either store energy or release it. Needless to say, chemical reactions always come with more heat production, meaning we lose power. It takes a while, aka is slow, and the metals in the batteries also get used up. Meaning, in the best case, with lithium iron phosphate, you can use them for around 5000 cycles. Now compare that to my graphene supercapacitor, whose datasheet claims 20,000 cycles. But then again, its current capabilities of only 20 to 40 amps seems low, even though its internal resistance of around 1 milliohm should let it output much more current like a capacitor can do. But before getting to that, here's an overview of the differences between the two technologies. And like I said before, capacitors were only held back by the limited capacity, which is now a thing of the past if my graphene supercapacitor is real. To find that out, I firstly visited the manufacturer's website to learn more about it. But it seems like there really is no additional information available about this capacitor other than what they already sent me along with it. And by the way, I got this thing for 185 euro from eBay. So I gotta say, having a non-clickable datasheet symbol on their site was not a good start. And if we mix that with the look of the cap, that is like an oversized LiPo battery, and the fact that its max voltage is 4.2 volts, which is also the max voltage for a LiPo battery, I gotta say that I was skeptical. And sadly, testing for 20,000 charge cycles was not possible, as well as finding out the max current this thing could take and output, because I'm obviously always limited by the equipment I have laying around. But luckily, I came up with two tests that should let me determine what we are looking at here. And let's start with the first, more scientific one, cold charge discharge tests. For that, I simply built up my battery tester setup and hooked up a normal supercapacitor, which I then charged up and discharged with 5 amps of current. As you can see in the final graphs, the voltage of the capacitor rises and then falls pretty linear, meaning this technology stores energy at every voltage level. Now let's compare that to a practical LiPo discharge curve, which, as you can see here, falls pretty linear between 3.3 volts and 2.5 volts, and afterwards crashes down super quickly. As a side note though, this linear voltage region would usually be at a higher voltage level, but I feel like my tested battery was pretty dead at this point. But anyway, that means that most energy is stored in this linear voltage region, and that is a pretty big difference between capacitors and lithium batteries. So after fully charging up my graphene supercapacitor, it was finally time to have a look at its discharge curve as well. And yes, what can I say? This looks just like the lithium battery curve. So my next thought was that maybe this is a special hybrid capacitor type that just discharges differently. And luckily for me, I had a lithium hybrid capacitor laying around from a previous video, which I tested next for reference. And sadly, this thing also charged up and discharged in a linear fashion. Okay, so far it does not look good for the graphene cap, but I wanted to do the last test anyway, just to be sure. You see, supercapacitors do not react very aggressively when, for example, hammering a nail through them. Okay, they might smoke a bit and heat up, but overall they are pretty safe. But a LiPo battery, on the other hand, loves to blow off some steam, create flames, lots of fumes, and tons of heat, which is not that safe. So I was expecting a similar behavior from the supposed graphene supercap, but to my surprise, it didn't react at all, even though it was partly charged up. It was so safe that I was even capable of having a closer look inside. And sadly, at this point I have to admit that I'm not a battery expert. And thus, I'm not 100% sure if that is the structure of a LiPo battery or not. So all in all, I cannot 100% say what I was dealing here with. But feel free to let me know what you think in the comment section below. With that being said, I hope you learned a bit about graphene and enjoyed the show. If so, consider supporting me through Patreon to keep it going. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!